Welcome, everybody. Woo! Welcome, everyone. Welcome to Union of Phoenix. My name is Richard Mirage. I'm the senior minister here, and it is great to see you, and a joy and a blessing to be with you all. Welcome, everybody. Good seeing you.
And my name is Jimmy Scott, pastoral care minister here at Unity of Phoenix. You know, Unity is a non-denominational organization that is based on the practical, easy for me to say, or even easier for me to remember, based on the practical teachings of Jesus Christ and interpreted by modern day standards. So we're all about prosperity, we're all about health, we're all about self-awareness, we're all about self-insight, and we're also about love and acceptance. So welcome.
All right, so Unity Phoenix has a mission, and it is the mission of our community, it is the mission of our ministry, and it's the mission of each and every one of us. So it'll appear up on the screen, and let us speak that affirmation and own it and speak it as your own truth. Together,
Unity of Phoenix is a loving spiritual community that welcomes all people and honors all paths to God. We are dedicated to transforming lives by inspiring and awakening individuals to discover God's Spirit within them.
Amen. Everybody, let's take a deep breath. Just open yourself to an amazing experience of God.
Now is that time in our service for a time of prayer and meditation. So if you have your cell phones with you, I want to encourage you to place those either on silence or vibrate. And Walter will lead us in our meditational song. I invite you to take a few moments now to just metaphorically get settled in to the consciousness of quietness and prayer. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Just a gentle reminder that we are always surrounded and enfolded in the presence and power of God. Whatever that may look like to you, whatever that may feel like to you, right now, at this point in our service, is a good time to just relax and to get comfortable in your seat. Take a deep, refreshing breath. And to mentally and intentionally let go of all the busyness of your life. Allow yourself to be fully present to yourself, to the power within you, and to the moment. I love the statement by Khalil Gibran that essentially states that the present moment is the only moment that is guaranteed to us. And therefore, it is incumbent upon us to get the most and the highest and the best from it. So again, just allow yourself to get into a comfortable space. To breathe freely and naturally. Let go of all the busyness of your life and your day. And for the next few moments, be quiet. Reflective and receptive. To your own indwelling spirit. As we reflect on our life, on our world, on our community, all the rich blessings that come our way on a daily and moment-by-moment basis, let us give thanks for all that is good and well. In the name and through the nature the living Christ. And so it is. Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debt as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Amen. We are so blessed. We are so blessed. Good morning again, everyone. And a shout out to everybody who tunes in and watches us online. How many people have ever believed or have been taught when life isn't working as well as you'd like, you just need to work a little harder? Anybody? How many people were taught or believe that the harder you work, the better things go? How many people have ever been working real hard and things not going as well as you'd like? Anybody? You know, so what if I told you? What if I told you that the key to greater success and happiness was not just about how hard you work, was not just about working harder, but there was something actually deeper to the true secret of greater success and happiness. And that key secret of what can make us far more successful and far happier in life is surrendering. Now, I can tell by your laugh of uncomfortableness and your complete feeling of being underwhelmed that you're not inspired by the word surrender, surrendering. And I'm really not surprised, because really in our culture, the word surrender has more of a negative connotation than it does have a positive one. You know, surrendering, to me, is one of the most misunderstood spiritual concepts that we have. It is so much more powerful than we realize, but it has often been associated with kind of waving the white flag, you know, kind of giving in, settling, or giving up. It kind of reminds me of the story about this big city California lawyer who went duck hunting in rural Texas, and he shot and dropped a bird, and it fell into a farmer's fence on the into a farmer's land on the other side of the fence, and so the lawyer started climbing the fence and to go retrieve his duck when the an old farmer came up on a tractor and said, "What are you doing?" And the lawyer said, "Well, I shot a duck and it fell into your field and I'm just going to retrieve it." And the old farmer said, "You know, this is my property. And that duck's on my property, so that's my duck." And the indignant lawyer said, "Look, old man, I'm one of the best trial attorneys in this country. And if you don't let me have that duck, I'll sue you and take everything you own." And the old farmer smiled and he said, "Young man, apparently you don't understand how we do things in these parts. We settle these small little disagreements with a thing we call the Texas three-kick rule." And the lawyer thinks, "The Texas three-kick rule?" And the farmer says, "Yeah. First, I'll kick you three times. Then you kick me three times. And then we go back and forth and back and forth till someone gives up. And whoever gives up, the other person wins. And in this case, the other person would get the duck." So the farmer's thinking about this proposed contest, and he's thinking, "Well, I can take this old codger. I mean, I could knock this guy senseless. So, sure, we'll do the deal." So the old guy slowly comes down the tractor, a little frail, and he walks up to the city slicker, and he kicks him right in the thigh, and it hurts so much it drops the lawyer to his knee. And then he kicks him in the stomach, and it knocks the wind out of him, and he locks him flat on his belly. Then he kicks him in the side, in the kidney, and he's, oh, wincing in pain, almost to the point of giving up. But the lawyer was determined, so he got himself up and shaking off the pain. He's still kind of hurting, and he said, "Okay, you old coot, now it's my turn." And the old farmer smiled and said, "No, I give up. You can have the duck." Whew, you can have the duck. Anyway, so surrendering, you know, we think it's about giving up. And I think one of the things is that we, at a deep level, don't believe that surrendering is a good thing. And certainly it's not a good thing for us, because in many ways it goes against our work ethic. You know, it goes against our belief in that being aggressive and driven and never stopping and always fighting and keeping pushing is the way to success. It's the way to a better life. And so the concept of surrendering seems almost counterintuitive to everything we think that success in life and achieving our goals are about. And to me, that's one of the reasons we struggle with surrender, but I think there are even deeper reasons we struggle. And it's not just because surrendering seems like we're weak or soft or passive. I think the real reason we're scared of surrender is because it really brings up our fear and it makes us vulnerable. And I think the idea of fear, of surrendering lets us go, because letting go scares that control freakish part of us that feels that we need to be in charge or that we need to know whatever is going on and to be able to control those things. And I think the lack of control that surrendering has absolutely scares us. There's something scary about surrendering. I remember when I was a kid and I was in church and I heard the minister say, surrender your will and your life to God. I was like, really? I have to do that? Is anybody other than me got scared by surrendering your life to God? It was like, stop, we think something freaky had happened. You know, at some level, we think, we get so vulnerable and scared, we think, you know, if I let go, what will I hold on to? You know, if I let go, maybe things will fall apart and things will get worse. If I let go, I don't know what I'll do. If I let go, maybe I'll lose and won't get what I really want. Or even scarier, if I let go, maybe I'll fall apart. If I let go, maybe I will actually lose myself. So in many ways, we are so scared of surrendering, we end up holding on, because the idea of letting go makes us feel so scared, so vulnerable. And yet, you know, we think holding on makes us safe, yet letting go and surrendering it actually will bring more good and abundance and peace into our lives. You know, Patanjali, who lived in the 4th century BCE, said in the Yoga Sutra, he said that surrendering to God facilitates and brings forth a feeling of oneness and inner peace and opens our hearts and our lives to divine intuition and divine wisdom. Letting go and surrendering actually opens the path to peace and to deeper intuition and insight. You know, Jesus put it this the same way. He said the words, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And blessed are the poor. The poor in spirit means to empty yourself of pride. Blessed are those who can empty themselves of their desires and their personal wills, and they will achieve self-actualization. Blessed are those who can let go of the past, who can be open and teachable and willing, and not need to intellectually understand everything, and then they will be able to go to a deeper level of inspiration and connection to spirit. How many people ever read anything by David Hawkins? Anybody ever read any stuff by David Hawkins? I love that guy. My favorite book I've read of his by far is one called Letting Go, The Pathway to Surrender. And one of the things he said is that letting go and surrendering and that regular practice of it is the most effective technique that there has been, and he said it's been done with research, that can reduce your stress, that can help you find inner peace, that can relieve your suffering, that can improve your physical sense of well-being, can increase your experience of love, can deepen your connection to God, and can add more fulfillment into your life. Think about that. That surrendering and letting go is a secret to greater success. It is a secret to greater happiness and joy and fulfillment. And to me, surrendering is a deep level of letting go that clears the path of all the stuff we're holding on to allow us to not only to connect with spirit, but to be in the flow of spirit. That the more we surrender, the more we experience peace, the more we experience clarity, the more we're present, and the more we can connect with the flow of spirit. You see, I don't want to put down hard work. Hard work's good. But when we're holding on to things, hard work can become exhausting, depleting, and draining. When we practice surrender, that work can actually become more efficient, more productive, more joyful, and more fulfilling. And so my question is, are you willing to allow yourself to learn how to surrender because I truly believe that surrender is not sour and scary. It's actually sweet and sacred and can take us to deeper levels than we can imagine if we're willing to learn to let go. So this morning, I want to share with you four things that can help us learn the power and the practice of sweet surrender. First thing is that it is important to get to a place of acceptance. I think surrender begins with a level of acceptance. And why is acceptance so important? It is because that many times in our lives, we spend a lot of time resisting what is, hating what has happened, wishing it didn't happen, thinking it shouldn't have happened, wondering why it happened, wondering how it happened. And you know what? When we resist and fight against life, we actually expend so much energy and it gets us absolutely nowhere. We fight against things that have happened already. We argue against them. We hate them. We resist them. We dislike them. How many people watched the Super Bowl last Sunday? Anybody watch the Super Bowl? Anybody remember the goal line play, second down and goal, the call? You know? And so anybody know what a Monday morning quarterback is? Somebody looks and criticizes and judges things that happened after the fact. Everybody, that one play that happened a week ago over the last week was saying, why didn't he run? Well, you got Marshawn Lynch. You got beast mode there. Why did you throw that pass? Why did they throw that pass? Anybody found yourself engaging in that? Because I know there are a lot of Seahawks fans, so I better see a couple of hands up. I mean, we did. We care. We're wondering, why did you do that? Why did you do that? See, we're resisting and fighting, even if it's not in our own lives. We resist and fight against things that, you know, that aren't even ours, that we have no control over whatsoever. One of the things I really loved was hearing Russell Wilson. Russell Wilson, he said, you know what? It didn't go the way we wanted. And, he said, nobody hates losing more than I. But the only thing I can do is to accept this and use this to fuel my comeback and my drive for next year. Pete Carroll as well, the party who made the decision, even he said, that's the call I made, I went with it, and it just didn't go. It wasn't the outcome we wanted. And yet the rest of the people around were Monday morning quarterbacking and judging. So I ask you, is there something in your life that has happened, that you are resisting and fighting, then you are Monday morning quarterbacking? Is there something you're resisting and you think it shouldn't have happened and it's wrong that it happened and you're expending energy on that thing and fighting against it? It is one of the quickest ways to rob ourselves of peace and joy, and it actually stops us from moving forward. It actually stops us from moving forward. And I'm not trying to say that it's an easy thing, because there are some tough things. You know, you lost a job. You know, someone got a cancer diagnosis. You know, someone's spouse might want to get a divorce. There's conflict in the family. You know, your body is getting older. You know, sometimes we want to fight against all these things. But the truth is, the only way we can move forward is to find a level of acceptance. To me, acceptance is about acknowledging reality as it is, finding peace with it, you know, and stop fighting against it. What's our first step in AA? It is that we admitted that we were powerless over alcohol and that our lives had become unmanageable. And to me, that's about acceptance, about surrendering that, okay, it's happened. This is what is going on. And it's to acknowledge it and to find peace with it. And to me, that's a tremendous and important thing. So, everybody, I want you to think of something in your life that you have been fighting against and resisting and disliking and wished it was different. Think of something. If you don't have anything, yeah, I got several. I could lend you a couple. So I want you to think about one. Think about something in your life you've been fighting against, you've been resisting. I want you to think about it, and I just want you to take a deep breath. And can you just let go? And can you find a place of acceptance and understanding, even if you don't like it, that this thing has happened, that this is what is before you? Take another deep breath. And can you just surrender and just find a place of peace? No, this will still get better, but just find peace and acceptance in it right here and now. And to me, that's the first step of surrender. And the second step is, to me, it's about opening yourself to greater possibilities by emptying yourself of all your feelings and thoughts and ideas. Anybody ever have your mind just chattering so much you couldn't stop your mind? Anybody ever have that experience? I think we all do. And generally speaking, all the things that clogs our mind, you know, that it tends to be a worry. You know, this shouldn't have gone well. We have worry. We have fear. We have all kinds of stuff. But you know what else actually gets in our way? Is when we're attached to a particular outcome. So even when we think it's a positive thought of, you know, I'd like this to happen, we get so attached of how we think it should happen, you know, that we can get stuck. We can get stuck in our attachment. We can get stuck in the way we think it is supposed to be, the way I think it should be. And so when we talk about, you know, opening a space and emptying ourselves, we need to let go of even the way we think it should go, not just the worry and fear. It's to let go of who we think we are, how we think like it is. And the more we empty ourselves, the more we actually open a space for Spirit to move in and through us in some greater way than even we might think for ourselves. You know, so this week I had a decision I need to make, and there was a certain outcome I wanted to have, and there were some options, and I thought option A was the smartest and best option. And then as I had opened and surrendered myself to the situation, I realized, option A, which I thought was brilliant, was not the way that was supposed to be. My gut kept saying that was not it. I went to a different option that was still an option, and amazingly, making that option not only helped fulfill the outcome that I had originally intended, but the outcome was actually even better. You know, sometimes when we think, this is the job that I want, and that's the way it should go for me to feel happy and blessed, sometimes that job may close and something greater will more likely open where your soul is meant to be. Sometimes we think it's that person I want to have a relationship. Sometimes that may actually turn into a friendship and turn into a business relationship or something different than you expected. The thing is, Spirit always has unlimited possibilities. And sometimes clogging ourselves that this is the way it's supposed to go and this is when and how it should happen actually restricts and limits. It's not just the fear and the worry that can limit it, but it's us, you know, thinking, why isn't it happening? It should happen now. This is the only way I think it should happen. And that's not true. We need to just clear the path. Surrendering is about clearing and opening ourselves to the unlimited possibilities. And there's so many more possibilities than what our own mind can think. So everyone, go back to your situation. And just, I want you to take a deep breath. And can you just let go of attachment, let go of how you think it should be, and just open a space of the unlimited possibilities for Spirit to bring forth an even greater answer than you think. Again, deep breath. And just open a space. Empty yourself and open a space for the amazing possibilities of Spirit. So the first thing is to accept and just let go, you know, and know the reality. The second is to open yourself to the possibilities by emptying your mind. And the third one is to let go at a deeper level, trusting that Spirit will bring something great for you, trusting that it'll be good. Here's one of my favorite stories. It's about a young preacher. And he's walking with an older minister, and he's talking with him, and he's saying, hey, you know, I'm not sure what my ministry is supposed to be, and I don't know what my next step is. You know, I just would love you to give me some advice and get a little concerned about it. And without saying a word, the old preacher goes over to this rose bush, and he picks a rosebud, and he hands it to the young man. And the young man is thinking, what's he doing? I'm asking him about my life, and I'm concerned about it. And then he's handing me a rosebud. And then so the old preacher said, I want you to open that rosebud with your hands without tearing any of the petals. And he thinks, what does this have to do with anything? But he respected the older preacher, so he started doing it. So he started unfolding the rose petals, and then he realized very quickly he couldn't do it at all without tearing the rose petals. And then as the older preacher saw this, he recited this poem to the young man. It is only a tiny rosebud, a flower of God's design, but I cannot unfold the petals with these clumsy hands of mine. The secret of unfolding flowers is not known to such as I. God opens this flower so sweetly when in my hands they die. I cannot unfold a rosebud, this flower of God's design. Then how can I have the wisdom to unfold this life of mine? So I'll trust in him for leading each moment of my day. I will look to him for guidance each step along the way. The pathway that lies before me, only my Heavenly Father knows. I'll trust him to unfold the moments just as he unfolds the rose. And so in the same way we trust to know that God will unfold that rose in its perfect time and its perfect way to maximize the beauty that it is here to give and share and be. That whatever it is you're worrying in your life, can you trust God with that same thing that you're concerned about right now, that God will unfold it in a perfect way to bring out the beauty of that experience and the beauty in yourself and those around you in the very same way. Daniel Nahman has a song called I Don't Need to Know. And one of my favorite lines, he says, I don't need to know how pain ends or how my heart mends. I can just let go because God knows. So can you trust in that area in your life? Can everybody take a deep breath and just let go? And can you surrender into a deeper experience of trust, knowing that God will unfold that situation in a way that will have an outcome that will bring forth the very best and the beauty in you and the beauty in everyone in the situation? The final thing I want to talk about with the process of surrendering is that when we surrender, you know, it helps us get into the flow of life. You know, it gets into a rhythm that we work with instead of going against, instead of avoiding. We are in that flow. But you know what? As we flow, you know, along that path, we still have to keep paddling. You know, that you don't get to stop paddling. That I think Roy Rogers once said, even if you're on the right track, if you just sit there, you'll get run over. That the fact is, in life, that when you listen to the guidance and surrender, you'll be given the direction of where to paddle, how fast to paddle, you know, how to paddle. And sometimes you paddle swift on certain decisions, some you paddle a little bit slower. But when you really surrender, you will be guided by Spirit as to what is the next thing for you to do, what is the next step for you to take. Alan Cohen once said something so brilliant, and here's what he said. I just love this. He said, when we let go of the activities that do not belong to us, our real self shines. I'll say it again. When we let go of the activities that do not belong to us, our real self shines. And that is, sometimes we get involved in people's lives and decisions and certain things that aren't any of our business. And we expend our energy thinking it's out of care or concern, when the reality is, if you check in and say, is this really my business or is this really mine to do, we'll often find out it is not. Sometimes we get caught up in stories, we get caught up in drama, we get caught up in all kinds of stuff in other people's lives, thinking that we're doing it out of care when it's truly none of our business. They are souls on their own path, and it's theirs to do, and it is not ours to do. And sometimes when we get involved in other people's stuff, it's actually a nice way for us to really avoid our own stuff. Is this making sense, everyone? Is that the guidance on this, when you surrender, you will know what is yours to do and what is yours not to do. And the more we are in line with what is truly ours to do, our spirit will shine, the work will become easier, it will become clearer, more effective, and we will become a beacon of light for those around us and not necessarily doing what is theirs to do for them. You know, every one of us, you know, resists and fights against life in some certain way. And sometimes if we keep doing it, you know, that the proverbial get hit by the proverbial 2x4, and to the point that we will just finally give up and surrender and open our lives. And we don't need to go there, you know, because we can practice this incredible, practice of letting go and surrendering at a deeper level, because it will connect us with the insight and the wisdom and the inspiration of God. I'll tell you, one of my favorite things about that entire book about David Hawkins was when he said that what we tend to do when life isn't going well, we can get to that place where we let go, where we surrender. But he says, when things start going well, we stop letting go because life's going good. What he said was, even when your life's going good, keep letting go. Keep surrendering. And you will unearth and free yourself from so many things, and insights and inspiration and revelations will take you quantum leaps ahead, because you will just keep letting go and surrendering and surrendering. See, human beings, we get a little scared. We hold on to things every day. So it's a good daily practice. But even when you're in the flow of life, keep surrendering and letting go, and it will take you to deeper levels. It will lift you to greater heights than you can imagine, because it clears the path for the divine to flow through you with ease and grace. So this week, anybody, if you're struggling in any area of your life and you find you're working so hard and you're getting nowhere, or if you're worrying and having anxiety about life, I invite you to do this amazing practice of letting go. It seems so simple, but I guarantee you it's so much more powerful. Will you, with whatever is going on in your life that you're resisting, will you take time to just to find acceptance and find peace in it and stop fighting against it? Are you willing to just let go and open a space and empty yourself for some greater possibility? Are you willing to trust that God can unfold your life just like the rose? And are you willing to do what is yours to do and only what is yours to do? Your life will shine. Your life will be lifted and transformed into greater ease and greater flow if you're willing to practice sweet surrender. God bless you all. Thank you, kids. Great job. Great job. Be safe. So, everybody, let's rise now as we close with our song of peace. All right, kiddos. Great job. Great job. Thank
you. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be. With God as creator, family all are we. Let us walk with each other in perfect harmony. Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now. With every step I take, let this be my solemn vow. To take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Let there be peace on earth, and let it be.
God bless you, everyone. Have a great day and a wonderful week. Thanks for being here.